Good day, everyone. Welcome to lecture number 25 of Theory of Computation. And in this particular lecture, we will be discussing about the push down automata. Okay. So before starting the discussion about the push down automata, what is a PDA? So we know we have already discussed about the DFA, which is also called a deterministic finite automata. So what is DFA? DFA is basically a mathematical model. And this is used to recognize regular languages. Or we can say DFA is an automata, is a finite automata for regular grammar, which is also a type 3 grammar. Okay. So this is about a DFA. And we know when we were discussing about a DFA, we said that DFA has three components. Has three components. One is the computational unit, or it is also called a control unit. And it has an input tape. This is an input tape. So input tape means a kind of memory where we are providing the input. And this control unit has a head that is reading input from this tape, and it is moving from left to right. It is reading input from this input tape, and then this control unit changes state or does some computation. And then this head moves to the next symbol. So this is the head. Okay. Head matlab, it is reading, meaning it is reading from this input tape. Okay. And it is moving from left to right. And when it encounters the last symbol, it stops. Whatever is the state of this control unit, that will be the last state of this computation. Okay. So this was about a DFA. Like DFAs for regular languages, we have push down automata, which is a mathematical model. For recognizing context-free languages. Or we can say push-down automata is a computational model for context-free grammars, which is a type 2 grammar. So what is the difference between a PDA and a DFA is that PDA is also an automata like the DFA. However, DFA recognizes regular languages, but PDA recognizes context-free languages. And we know a regular language is a subset of context-free languages. What does that mean? It means the power of PDA is more than the DFA. DFA or we can say NFA, because NFA and DFA have the same power. It is also said that expressive power of PDA is more than DFA. Why expressive power of PDA is more than DFA? It is because PDA recognizes context-free languages, whereas DFA recognizes regular languages. And we know regular language is a subset of, so if it is a regular language, this is a context-free language. So regular language is a subset of context-free languages. Or in other words, we can say these problems, regular problems is a subset of this problems. So PDA is solving these problems. PDA. What does that mean? It means PDA can solve not only context-free problems, but also regular problems as well. However, DFA can only solve regular problems. That means PDA are stronger than the DFAs. So what makes PDA stronger than DFA? So there should be some extra component in the PDA because of which it is much stronger than the DFA. So let's see what are the components of a PDA and how those components differ from the components of a DFA. So what are the components of a DFA? DFA have two components. One is the control unit and the second is input tape. Okay. So these are the two components of a DFA. So let's see what are the different components of a PDA. So we have a push down automator. So like DFA, push down automator have following three components. So DFA was having only two components. It has three components. And what are those three components? The first component is the control unit. It is same as there is in the DFA, control unit. Control unit is doing the computation, or we can say changing the state. Second is input tape. So it is also with the DFA. So these two are with the DFA as well. However, there is one extra component with the PDA, and that extra component is stack memory. Okay, and this stack memory has infinite size. And because of this stack memory, PDA are stronger than DFAs. Okay. This extra stack memory makes the PDAs stronger than DFAs. Okay. So what is a stack memory? You may have already studied about a stack memory. So stack memory is a special kind of memory where data items are stored in first in, last out manner. First in, last out manner. What does that mean? So if this is my stack memory, okay, this is a stack memory. Let's suppose I am putting some data on the stack memory. Let's say A. Then after A, I am putting B. Then after B, I am putting C. So which was the first element that I put? A. So if I have to remove A, I have to first remove C, then remove B, and then I can remove A. So it is first in. This was the first one that got in, and it is the last out that got out. Okay. So that is a stack memory. Fine. So in stack memory, we have to only remember the top of stack. So we should remember top of stack. And what are the operations permitted on stack memory? So the two operations permitted on stack memory are, so the first operation is push. Push means that when we are putting some data, on stack. So at which location we should put data? On the top of stack. And the second operation that is permitted on stack is pop. Pop means removing data from stack. And which data? The data present on top of stack. Okay, top means the last entry that contains the data. Fine. So this is the PDA. So PDA have following three components. It has a control unit. It has an input tape. Okay. It has a stack memory of infinite size. And this stack memory makes PDAs stronger than DFAs. And what are the operations that are permitted on a PDA, on a stack memory? One is the push operation and another is a pop operation. Okay. So what is the working of a PDA? So let's see how does our PDA work. So as I said, we have a control unit. Control unit means it will have some states. Okay. Then it has an input tape. So this is the input tape. And on this input tape, we provide the input. Okay. Provide the input. For example, if I have some string. Okay. So I have to put that string on this input tape. And if I have to see whether my PDA accepts this string or not, I will provide this string on this input tape. Then my PDA will process this string. And this string belongs to sigma star. So sigma is our alphabet set. Input alphabet set. And what is this PDA doing? So as I said, it has a control unit, it has an input tape, and it has a stack. So this is stack here. Okay. So stack memory. What is the initial state of stack? Initially, it is empty. Okay. So let me make these entries here. What is my PDA going to do? It has two heads. One head points to the input tape and another head points to the top of stack. So currently top of stack is this. Okay. So there are two heads. So one head is on the input tape and another head is attached to the stack memory. So we have two heads. So the first head attached to input tape and the other head is attached to stack mem. Now let's see what is the process, how it works. So what it is going to do, first step is, so control unit will read input from input tape with the help of head attached to the input tape. Okay. Second, control unit will read top of stack, what is present on top of stack. So there will be something present on the top of stack. So initially we place one symbol on the top of stack that is represented by Z0. So Z0 is the initial symbol that is on the stack. It is also called a initial stack symbol. Okay. So control unit will read top of stack. So the two things it is going to read, control unit, input and the top of stack. Then after reading these, it will make some computation. Okay. So this computation, what the computation that it is making, it depends on three parts. One is current state of the control unit plus input symbol red plus top of stack that it read from the stack memory. So based on these three, it will make some computation. It will make some computation means it will update its state. Update its state plus. So in finite automata, let me differentiate it here with the DFA. In DFA, the DFA was reading. So we were having current state plus input. And based on these two, it was changing a state. So new state, Q dash. However, in case of a PDA, we have a current state. We read data from the input tape. So input symbol. This is the input symbol plus top of stack. So these are three components. And based on these three, we make a transition. Transition means we reach to a new state, Q dash, plus there is some additional. Additional is we write some string on top of stack. Okay. Plus, what I am saying here, it will update its state plus we will update the top of stack. So that means we will write some string on top of stack. Fine. So this is the complete operation of a PDA. So you can see that in case of a DFA, so in our DFA, when we have a DFA, so our operation, so the operation is, or we can say the computation. The computation is that we have the current state plus we have the input symbol. Okay. And based on this, we make a transition. Transition means we do a computation. We got a new state, Q dash. So that means in case of a DFA transition function, the transition function that we are defining, transition function, or we can say the computation is a function that takes the state and input alphabet as the input and provides the output a new state. Okay, new state Q. However, in case of an PDA, so what is the difference? In case of a DFA, computation depends on three parts. One part is the current state plus input symbol plus top of stack. Okay. And based on this, we will go to a new state Q dash plus we will write some string on stack. So we will write some string on top of stack. T here is top of stack. So what kind of string? So we know we have alphabet. One is alphabet. This is the input alphabet. Input alphabet. Or we can say this is an alphabet set from which we are creating the input strings. However, apart from these input alphabets, there are extra symbols that are present, or we can say extra alphabets that are present on stack. So stack has different alphabet set. It is not same as the input alphabet set. It can be same as input alphabet set, but it can be different alphabet set as well. So that alphabet set is represented by this gamma. Okay. Okay. So this alphabet set, as you can see, we have already discussed one of the alphabet in this set, and that is Z0. Z0 is the initial symbol that is present on the stack. So it may contain multiple symbols. This new string that we are putting on the stack during a computation, that string belongs to this sigma. So that means that string is a subset of sigma star. Okay, sorry, gamma star. This is gamma here. Okay, gamma star. So that means here we are writing on top of this stack a new string. A new string that is made from these alphabets. What are these alphabets? Stack alphabets. So that means in case of a PDA, our transition function has input. It is a function from state, input alphabet, and top of stack. Top of stack will be an alphabet from this gamma. And the output is, that means it is a function from this three triplet to a couple. Couple means that we have two outputs. One output is a state and another is the string that is written on the top of stack. Okay. So this is the computation of a PD. And this is the transition function of a pushdown automata. And I have shown you here how it differs from the transition function of a DFA. Okay. So here you can see that our PDA, so for example, our DFA, if we have a DFA, it has five components. So what where it has five components? One where it we are having set of states. Another component was it we are having the input alphabet set. Another was it was having an initial state. Another was it was having a transition function. And the last one, it was having a set of states that are final states. Okay. And in case of PDA, you can see that there are seven components. So here we were having five components. So a DFA can be defined by defining these five components, and PDA can be defined by defining seven components. So what are the seven components? The first is, you can see the same set of states. Second is an input symbol. Third is the stack symbols. Fourth is the initial state. Fifth is transition function. Sixth is initial stack symbol. Initial stack symbol. And the seventh is the set of final states. Okay. So by defining these seven components, you can define a push down automaton. Okay. So let me formally define what is a push down automaton. Push down automaton. So we have already informally discussed about the push down automaton, but let me discuss it here. What is the push down automaton formally? Okay. So a push down automaton is a seven tuple entity. That is this Q sigma. Stack alphabet, transition function, initial state, initial symbol on the stack memory, and the final state. Okay. So let me define each one here. Q is the set of states. Okay. And sigma is the input alphabet set. Gamma is the stack alphabet set. Delta is a transition function. And we know that transition function, it is a function from Q, input alphabet, stack symbol, or we can say the top of stack. It is written as T, top of stack, and the output is some state and the string written on top of stack. Okay. This is a transition function. So, or I can write it. It is like this: transition Q, A is input symbol, and T is top of stack, and the output will be Q dash new state, and the string written on top of stack. Okay. And Q zero is the initial state. Okay. And Z0 is the initial stack symbol. Fine. And F is the final states. Fine. So this is the formal definition of a push down automaton. So I hope you understood this. What is a push down automaton? Now I have some important, we can say, definitions that you have to keep in mind. The first thing that you have to understand is, what is an instantaneous description? So for example, if my PDA is running, okay, so it is running means it is taking strings, it is taking input alphabets, and based on those alphabets, it is changing its state and it is writing something on the stack. Okay, so instantaneous description means the current status of a PD. Current status of a PDA, or it is written as ID, instantaneous description. So that means at any state, you can simply tell what is the current state of the PDA, and that can be described with the help of instantaneous description. Okay. So how you can determine the current status of the PDA? We know PDA has three components. What are its components? State. So these are the three important components that you have to keep in mind. State, input to be processed, and data present on stack. So if you are able to remember these three parts of a PDA, you will be able to describe its current status. Okay, so what you have to describe, for example, if my PDA is running, so let's say my PDA is running. Okay, so let's say the input string was this A A A B C C. Let's say this is the input string, fine. And let's say on top of stack initially is Z0. Let's say my PDA is running. PDA is running. Okay. So let's say it has processed these two. These two symbols it has processed. So what is the remaining input? A, B, C, C. This is the remaining input. Remaining input to be processed. And let's say currently when it has completed these two stack containers following string, let's say Z0AE. So it has followed. So you have to remember that we always write the top of stack first. Let's say on top of stack, we have this A. Okay. So let's say on the stack, we have this AAZ0. And currently the state of PD is Q. Okay. Now let's say at this point only, this point means I have completed these two. I have to save the current status of PDA so that I will keep the status of PDA stored, and at later point of time, I will ask this PDA to run again. To run again means that I will ask it to consume the remaining string. Okay. So how I can store the status of a PDA? So this is the current status of a PDA. So what I have to store in my memory? So if I want to stop my PDA and I will ask my PDA to run again later in the time, that means I have to store that up to which point it has completed, what was there on the stack, and what was the state of the PDA. So that means I have to store the state of PDA, plus I have to store the remaining input, to be processed, plus stack contents. So these are the three important parts that I have to store. Okay. So this state plus W, let's say W represents the remaining input to be processed, plus S. So S is the stack contents. So this forms the instantaneous description of a PD. So what is the instantaneous description of a PDA? Instantaneous description of a PDA means current state plus input that is to be processed, remaining input to be processed plus stack contents. Okay. Now let's say I have consumed this A. Again, I have consumed this A. Okay. One symbol I have consumed. Fine. So let me write it here. So let's say this instantaneous description was Q A B C C. And what was the stack content? Stack contents were A A Z C. So now let's say I have consumed this A. What is the remaining string? So remaining string is B C C. And let's say I have removed this A on the stack. So what is there on the stack? So on stack, we have A0. And let's say new state is Q dash. Now at this point of time, what is the instantaneous description? So the instantaneous description is Q dash, BCC, and AZ0. Okay. Now let's say I have consumed this B also. Now let's say remaining string is CC and on stack, let's say we have new again AAZ0 and new state is Q double dash. So what will be the instantaneous description? It will be Q double dash, comma CC, comma AAZ0. Okay. So you can see that this was instantaneous description one. From this instantaneous description, if I consume one symbol, I will go to another instantaneous description. And what is the next one? Q dash, comma BCC, comma AZ0. And from this, when I have consumed B, I have reached to another instantaneous description. What is that? Q double dash, CC, AAZ0. So let's see. Let's say from this instantaneous description, I have consumed this C, okay? And I have reached to another state, Q triple dash C A Z zero, okay? And from this, I have reached to another description, Q four times dash. So this is completed, C. C means now it has nothing, epsilon A Z zero, or it may be A Z zero, whatever it is, okay? So when we have reached to this instantaneous description, this means when we have epsilon here means I have completed processing of input. So here, then I will decide whether my string, this input string has been accepted or not. So what I am trying to make you understand here that we are moving from one instantaneous description to another instantaneous description, or we can say this instantaneous description ID1 derives ID2. This ID2 derives ID3. Okay. In a single step. Single step means it consumes only one symbol of the input and derives a new instantaneous description. And in simple terms, it is represented by this notation. This is the 90 degree rotated T. Okay. So that means if I am writing ID1 derives ID2, it means instantaneous description 2 is derived from instantaneous description 1 in single step. Single step means single step. What does that mean? Single step means by consuming one input symbol. Okay. And this notation is called turnstile notation. Okay, instantaneous description one derives instantaneous description two. Now we can write it instantaneous description one derives instantaneous description two, and instantaneous description two derives instantaneous description three, instantaneous description three derives instantaneous description four. In short notation, I can write that instantaneous description one can derive instantaneous description four directly by using one or more steps, and that is represented by this turnstile notation with star on top of it. Star means that this description derives this description in more than one steps. If we directly have a turnstile notation with no star mark, it means that one instantaneous description derives another instantaneous description in a single step. So let me give an example here where we will understand the working of a pushdown automatic. So the example is, so let's take a context-free language. Let's take L is equal to A raised power N, B raised power N. So this is a language, and we have to design a PDA push down automata that recognizes this particular language. Okay. So to design a PDA, any push down automata, you have to understand when we are processing an input. So when I am processing an input, I should make a decision. What will be a new state? So I have to make the two decisions. What will be a new state? And what is to be pushed on top of stack? So these are the two things that you have to remember. Stack. Okay. Fine. So this is what you have to understand. Whenever we are processing an input, we have to say that for every computation, what will be a new state and what is to be pushed on top of stack. So here I have to design a push down automata for this language. I know this is a context-free language. So this implies there exists a PDA. Okay. Fine. So exists a PDA, it means I have to define what are the states of that PDA. What is the alphabet set? So you can see alphabet set is here A comma B. Okay. We have to understand what is delta. We have to understand the transition function. Okay. We have to understand what is the initial state. Let's say initial state is Q0. What is the initial symbol? Initial symbol is Z0. And we have to understand what will be the final state. Okay. So let me understand. Let's do this particular work. Okay. How we will design a PD. What we are going to do. So our PDA should accept those strings which belong to this language. So what are those strings? Those strings where we have A's. First we have A's, then we have B's. Okay. And number of A's is equal to number of B's. Okay. This should be equal. So what we are going to do, we have to design a PDA. We will say, so this is our stack. Okay. So when we are processing a string, okay, so string should be of this format. It should start with A and end with B's. Okay. So that means when I am seeing an A, so initially what will be there on the stack? Initially there will be Z0, initial symbol. So let's say if I am, so this is the top of stack. This is the top. So what is right now top? Top is Z0. So what I am saying, if I am seeing an alphabet A, then what I am going to do, I will push an alphabet, new alphabet A on stack. Okay. So that means on top of stack, there was Z0. Now I will push on at Z0, I will write AZ0. AZ0 means that I am pushing another element here, A. Now top of stack is this. Now my top of stack is A. Now again, if I have seen A, so I will push again A, capital A. So now I will push on top of stack, there will be AA. So A is already there, so I will add another A. So that means I am pushing A. Pushing A means that on top of stack, we are rewriting the same symbol and an extra A. Okay. Now, what we are going to do, that for all A's, we will go on pushing capital A's on the stack. So we will go on pushing these. Okay. Now, let's say my top of stack is here. And I have completed A's. So A's have been completed. Now there will be B's. Okay. Now on every B, so for B, I will write epsilon on top of stack. Top of stack. So that means if B comes, so currently on top of stack, we have A, okay? And now, so top of stack is A. Now I am saying if there is B, I will write on top of stack epsilon. So here, instead of A, there will be epsilon. Epsilon means that there is nothing. Nothing means this will move here, the next one. So writing epsilon is same as popping data. So removing data from the stack. So I can say for B, I will pop top of stack. Top of stack. This is same as writing epsilon on top of stack. Now for every B, what we are doing? We are doing a pop. Now let's say there were 10 A's. So how many capital A's were there on the stack? 10 capital A's. Now after 10 A's, if there are 10 B's, so after processing 10 B's, so I would have removed all these 10 A's. So where would I have been? I have been at Z0. However, if there are less than 10 B's, what does that mean? It means I have not removed all A's. That means number of small A's is not equal to number of small B's. That means my top of stack is at this position, is pointing to some data A, because I have not removed all the A's. Now, if if number of B's is greater than 10 B's, so that means I have reached to the bottom of the stack and still number of B's have not completed. That means number of A's is not equal to number of B's. So let me repeat it here. What I am saying that for every A, I will push A's on stack. For every B, I will pop the stack. Pop means remove the topmost. But in both these cases, you have to remember that A is should be only at beginning, and B is should be only at the end. Only at the end. Okay. So let's take a string. Let's take this string. Okay. Should this string be accepted? Let's see. So I am only here making you understand the stack. So we have to understand the state transitions also. So initially it is Z0. So let's say I have processed A. Processed A means that I will push A on stack. So I will write A on stack. Now there is another A. So I will write another A on stack. So there is another A. So I will write A on stack. So this is top of stack. Now there is B. B means I will pop the stack. Remove this. So I will remove this. Now my top of stack is this. Another B. I will remove this. Now my top of stack is this. Another B. I will remove this. Now my top of stack is Z0. When I am aware that there is nothing in the input that there is epsilon. When I am sure that for input is epsilon and top of stack is Z0. I will say string is accepted. Okay. So this string will be accepted. Now let's take another string, AAB. Will this string be accepted? No. Let's see. When I am processing A, I will push A here. When I am processing another A, I will push A here. When I am processing B means I will remove this. Now what is there? Epsilon. So here we have epsilon and top of stack is, so we are here. Top of stack is A. So it will say reject. So it will say accept only when there is epsilon and top of stack is Z0. So that means when my input is epsilon and top of stack is Z0, I will move to a final state, QF. That is a final state. Fine. Now let's take another one, AB. So let me rub this. So let me make some space here. So what I am saying, AB. So this string should be rejected. Why it should be rejected? Here number of A is equal to number of B's. But number of A should be at the beginning and number of B should be at the end. But here it is not seen. So let's see what we have designed and whether it will accept it or not. So initially we have A. So it will push A. Now we have B. It will pop A. Pop A means top of stack is here. Now there is A. It will push A. Now there is B. It will pop A. Okay. Now we have epsilon and top of stack is Z0. So it will accept it. But it should reject. We know that it should reject. So that means this thing only will not complete our design. We have to add something else. What we have to add? We will add states. Okay. States means that initially we have Q0. Q0 means we have started from the initial state. Now, if I am in Q0 initially, so that means I should see A is only. Okay.
So up to the point where I have A is only, I will remain in this state. Okay. Now when A's are completed, when A's are completed, okay, then I should see B is only. So that means when it has completed A's and it has started seeing which B's, it should move to another state Q1. Q1 means that I should see B is only. Now, if I am in state Q1 and I have started seeing A's, that means this string won't be accepted because my push down automata should be such that there should be A's at the beginning and B's at the end. So what I have designed states, one is Q0, another is, so let me rewrite it. So I have the following states, Q0, Q1, and Q final. Now in Q0 state, this state, Q0. So this is the initial state. In Q0 state, if I am seeing A's, so what I am seeing A's, okay? I will remain in this state. I won't change the state. So I will remain in this state, okay? But you have to remember A's, so I am seeing A's and top of stack is Z0, okay? Or top of stack is A. I should remain in state Q0. So what I am saying, if I am in state Q0 and I am seeing what A and top of stack is Z0, I should remain in the same state and I should write on the stack. What should I write on the top of stack? I should write AZ0. AZ0 means Z0 was there. I will push A. Okay. So when I am on top, when I am seeing A and I am in state zero and top of stack is Z0, I should remain in this state and top of stack should be AZ0. So this is how it is written. So this transition, this complete transition. So how I have represented it? So I have represented it like this. So this means I was in Q0. So I am in Q0. I have seen A. Input is A. And top of stack is Z0. Top of stack is Z0. So what it is saying, I should remain in Q0. So I will remain in Q0. And I should write on top of stack AZ0. So this should be on top of stack. Okay. So when I am seeing, I will remain in the same state and I will go on pushing on the stack. Instead of Z0, we can write Z. Z means any symbol. So I will write AZ. Fine. Now, if I am in state Q0, I have seen B. So I am in state Q0, I have seen B and top of stack is Z. So that means I should move to a new state Q1. So that state means now I will start seeing B's. Okay. Now I should not see A's. Okay. So top of, so it should change the state Q1. And what should we write on the top of stack? We should pop. Pop means we should remove. So on top of stack should be epsilon. So we should remove this Z. This Z may be anything, A, B, anything. Okay. So if I am seeing B, B and top of stack is Z, then I should write on top of stack. I should do a pop. Pop means write epsilon. And I should move to which state? Q1 state. Okay, now let's see what is there on the Q1 state. So if I am in Q1 state and I am seeing B's and top of stack is Z, what should I do? I should remain in the same state and do a pop. Always do a pop. So this will be represented by this representation. So B, Z. Now, if I am in Q1 and I have seen A, okay, if I am in Q1, I have seen A and top of stack is Z. So that means it should halt. What is the meaning of halt? Halt means that it will reject the string. Reject the string because this should not be there. Okay, so it should reject the string. So this kind of transition, halt kind of transition, we won't add that transition here. So that if there is some transition missing, that means that is a halt transition, or we can say that is the reject the string. Now, if I am in Q1, okay, and I have seen B, and there is nothing on top of stack, or we can say there is Z0 on top of stack, Z0. So that means I have completed popping of A's. Okay, those A's which we are pushed by small A's. So I have completed popping of A's, but still there are some B's. There are still some B's. So what should I do? I should again do a halt. Halt means that it should reject the string. In that case, number of B's is greater than number of A's. Number of B's is greater than number of A's. Another is, let's say number of B's is less than number of A's. So that means, so that will be if I am Q1 and we have completed the string and top of stack is A. So that also means halt. Halt means reject. So when will be accept? Accept will means when I am in Q1, string has completed means there is epsilon only and top of stack is Z0. Z0 means I have removed all the stacks. So that means I have accepted the string. So I will go to QF state and I can write anything on the stack. That doesn't matter. Okay. Or we can say we will write the same string. So here our QF is that from this Q1, I will go to QF. If I am seeing epsilon means we have completed the input. In top of stack is Z0. So we will rewrite Z0 and we will go to QF. Or we can write, or we can say that epsilon Z0 and we have written epsilon. Epsilon means we have popped this Z0 as well. So we have reached to this state. Fine. And this will be our final state. So this will be a push down automata that accepts only those strings that are of this form. So you can check yourself that it will accept only those strings that are of this particular form. Okay, so this completes the discussion of this particular example where we are saying that we have to design a PDA for this particular language. So here I have given you that a language will be accepted if we reach to a final state. So this is same as we are doing as in the DFEs, but there is some difference. So what is the difference here? So the difference is, so when we are saying a PDA accepts a string, so that means we have to discuss acceptance by a PDA. When we are saying that PDA accepts a string, so the acceptance by a PDA, so it has two different approaches. So in our DFAs, we were having only one approach of acceptance. We were saying that if we reach to a final state, that means accepted. So it means accepted. If we are in non-final state, so that means rejected. So this was the only approach of acceptance in DFAs. But in PDAs, there are two different approaches where we say that a string is accepted. So this acceptance by a PDA and some examples of PDAs and how context-free grammars are equivalent to PDAs. These three subtopics we will be discussing in our lecture number 26. Okay. So let me stop this particular lecture here. And here, as I can repeat, that we have discussed what is a PDA and how we can design PDAs, what are the different components of a PDA, and we have also given one example. But this example will become clear when we first understand when we call that a PDA accepts a string. We will first understand this, then we will write some of the examples to understand the PDAs, and we will also discuss how CFGs are equivalent to PDAs. So let's meet in the next lecture. Till then, goodbye.